Food and Agriculture Organization, Ghana's production of marine fishes has been declining from 400,000 tons of fish in 1993 to now somewhere below 200,000 tons. Today on Food Chain, we'll be speaking to an expert in the aquaculture sector. We want to understand how the advent of fish ponds and backyard production of fish would help address the decline in fish stocks in the country. Thank you for joining us on Food Chain today. My name is Prince Apia.
So here we have just about six tanks.
And this is Dr. Shadra Kamponsa, a PhD holder in machinery agriculture. On the side, he is a passionate fish farmer at Fumesa in Ashanti region.
Basically, here we should have about 2,500 fishes here at the cottage.
Catfish and tilapia are the common fishes that many fish farmers breed for commercial purposes. For some time, tilapia production became the toast of many breeders, but it seems catfish production is gradually taking over from tilapia. So what could be the reason?
Juveniles, they've been here for the past 6 weeks. Usually they come in the size like that. Then from the hatchery, from the day old to this size, they could be around 3 months. It's surprising that you see a juvenile like that and then you think that, oh, this one is like 2 days, but it's been like 3 months at the hatchery from day zero. Yeah, so that's how it works. Then once they come here, they come for grow out. So we grow them out to bigger size. So before you get a fish to be like this size, then you're talking about somewhere 9 months. Yeah, there about, yeah. So that's how it works. So from here, usually what we do is that we try to do sorting. Interestingly, this is a technology we are promoting, we are pushing. We call it the recirculating aquaculture setup. So with a recirculating aquaculture setup, with the same stock of water you have in here, it keeps recycling the water, removing the waste, and then also ensuring that you can save some water. So you see that the water is being circulated by this pump, and at the same time it's pumping in some extra oxygen. Once you are applying centrifuge to the water, all the waste is centralized. Then the hoses you see there all bring the waste from the central position into that waste bucket. That waste bucket has a mesh setup that traps the solid waste that can easily be disposed of by the opening of the valve. And then the clean water now is pumped back because we need a system to keep running. That's how can we call it recirculating aquaculture setup. So the water keeps recycling. And then what we do is that once it goes down after removal of waste, we only top up. But we don't change this water. So this water keeps recycling over and over. Even for water scarce zones, this is a perfect technology you can use. And it comes in so handy. Within 4 to 6 months, you are ready, you know, to harvest.
Apart from the fact that it helps to manage the water you use,
yeah,
what else does keeping the water recycled, what does it do to the production here?
Right, so here, once I'm feeding them, of course you'd expect them to produce fecal matter, isn't it? So the fecal matter that we collect in the waste bucket goes straight to our crop fields. So on the crop fields, we use no fertilizers at all. It's organic. Everything we do, we produce our own tomatoes, we produce our own pepper and all those things that we use for the girls. In that system, it's like a closed loop where nothing is waste. So whatever waste we find here is useful for the plants. The best, I'll say, technologies you can ever think of when you want to actually do backyard farming of fish, or even for commercial purposes, you can actually use the recirculating aquaculture setup, and that's what we do at the cottage. So Wantesty Ventures is actually spearheading this throughout the entire nation, trying to see how best we can send fish ponds to every home in the country. So with this system, all you do is to open the valve, and then the waste that has been collected here goes away without any problems, and then you are able to still use the same water that has been recycled over and over again. And then it's one of the best you can ever think of. I think that you cannot smell anything.
Yeah.
The simple reason is that the bio filtration is working at its optimum. So you don't have any problem with smell. At your backyard, you can do this, you know, and it's so sustainable and it's so easy to manage and all. It doesn't take so much. Let me just add that for the one that I have at home and for those who have it, when I wake up in the morning, I spend just about 10 minutes maximum to feed the fish and to take the care of the waste. Then in the evening, I do the same thing. So worst case, 30 minutes a day, and then you're able to still grow your fish. I always call it investment at my backyard. So I see my investment grow. And then the good thing for catfish farmers in Kumasi, Ashanti region and its environs is that the cottage actually buys the fish from our clients. So once you have fish, we have helped you to produce, we buy from you. The reason is that we want to give clients the best quality of fish. So we know how we want to produce it to reach that kind of quality that we want. So once we have installed a system like this for you, you are sure that we will still buy from you and you'll be good to continue with your production.
So we are still here with engineer Dr. Shadrach Amponsa. And he's been telling us about how this particular fish pond works, the new technology employed, and all that. We will continue with this discussion, but now we want to understand if an individual wants to start a fish pond like this in his or her backyard, what should the person consider? What are the things the person must look out for to be able to go through it easily? So Doc, tell us.
It's one of the simplest systems to install in any setting. What we need from our clients, we have five things we look out for. We don't just come to do an installation. First of all, you need to have a well-drained, leveled ground. Well-drained, leveled ground. Two, you need to have access to water because we need water to, you know, nourish the fishes. And then three, we need access to electricity so we can power the biofiltration setup. And then four, we need you to have a fenced area. I wouldn't want to hear that anyone has set up a pond and then the next 4 months you go and then there's no fish in there. You have people harvesting for you. And then finally, and most importantly for me, is a committed manager, someone who will be committed to taking care of the system for you. If it's not for you, if it's not you going to do that, you need to get someone who will be there to, you know, manage it for you, because it accounts for about 80% of your success. If the person does not feed them well, the person does not take care of the waste, then your system shuts down. That ends it, you know, so your investment goes down the drain. So we need a committed manager. That's the final condition we will want to look out for before we come in to even establish.
So we know that for every business to start, the capital to begin with is very critical.
Right.
For something like this, how much investment must one make to get it going?
Right. I know this is the question everyone wants to hear an answer for. About 6 months ago, we were looking at 12,500. Unfortunately, now we are looking at about 14,000 cities. And you can have a setup like this fully stocked. It's a full package. The package includes the tank, the filtration setup. You have 1,000 pieces of catfish. You have 30 bags of fish feed. You have training. It takes care of the service charge. As a matter of fact, our training and technical support is free of charge. But then you need to subscribe to any of the packages to enjoy that training and then technical support for free. So it covers everything except the water you have to provide and then the electricity connection.
We are still here with engineer Dr. Shadrach Amponsa, and he's been giving us some tips. If anybody out there wants to get into fish
farming. In this way, you only need 15,000 Ghana cedis or less to begin with. From this point, we want to understand who Dr. Shadrach Amponsa is, how it started for him, and what motivated him to start this aquaculture production.
It was through a project that we ran in 2014 with the Brazilians. And then they have done this way back in some years ago. And then we happened to do a collaborative research work. So we were to disseminate this technology as an integrated approach to farming, and that you know about already. And along the line, when I saw how I'm able to bring in some innovative ideas to make it better and enhance it and push it, you know, in my own small way, then the interest started. Even when we started, I remember way back in 2016, we were doing all these ponds for free. When we go to people's houses, they only pay for the material cost. And then I gather my boys, we go, and then they pound fufu for us, we are happy, and then we are enjoying. And that interest, you know, the plan was not to actually sell it, but to just put a smile on someone's face who is shown interest. You know, it was just a passion, purely passion driving us. Some few years down the line, we realized that, you know, all these guys, their project has fizzled out, and then these young guys were following me, were, you know, just home, they couldn't get anything. I said, no, then this is an opportunity to do something. You know, it was also spearheaded by the fact that when we're doing this ponds for free, people started coming up, doctor, we have produced so much fish, we are not getting market. Then it became a headache for me. Said, every time they call you, we are not getting market. How can we sell our fish? Then it created a problem. But that problem was, I would say, a blessing to me. Because then it kept me thinking, what can I do? You know, as an engineer, you are trained to think and solve problems, bring innovative solutions to problems. So I said, no, let's do something about this. So I started with fish processing. How do we process a fish? The plan was, if I'm able to give a client an assurance that you can get market for your fish, because that's the main problem, then the client will be motivated. You know, it becomes an incentive for the client to do more of the production. And that's exactly what we started. So we started with even doing fish barbecues and all that from catfish, you know, fillet, boneless fish and all that. We're doing these things at home with one of my daughters. You know, she's in the catering school. And then it worked out. We invite friends and family, and then it started. I was okay, good. If I'm able to solve the problem of marketing, I've solved all the problems. And that's exactly how it happened. With time, people were, oh, so you buy the fish? I said, yes, I'll buy. So then they started contracting us for these ponds. Then as the day goes on, I gave you the history that we started with wood. So wooden structure with tarpaulin covering, we set up the bar filter. The bar filter has gone through a lot of changes. It was not like this. We wanted to enhance it, make it better for everyone to use it. So like I said, I spent about 10 minutes, you know, and I'm done maintaining the pond, feeding it, removing the waste. 10 minutes. And now, we are even doing collapsible structures. So you can even set it wherever and then dismantle it whenever you decide to. You know, and that is what I see as one of the very good innovations you can ever think of. Because people are renting. So someone came here to me, doctor, I want to do it, but I'm renting. What do I do? Then it started keeping me, you know, on my toes. What do I do to solve that problem? That I want to give you a pond that you can still carry along when you move from the house. Then they said, let's do collapsibles. So any size of tank you want, by the grace of God, we're able to design for you. And we tailor make the system so that it fits the needs of the client. And that's what we do. Like I said earlier, those in Ashanti region and environs are lucky to have the cottage here because it's a farmer's market. Once you produce and you are ready, you call us. Once you are a client, we buy from you first. We give you priority before we look up to elsewhere from other people who are producing from with other systems. So that is what we do here at the cottage.
Has your background as an engineer helped
in changing the face of the pond structure over time and making it better to now?
To a very great extent. It has everything to do with what we see today, because like I said, engineers are trained to think and come up with demand-driven solutions. So like I said, demand-driven. So you realize that all the story, the history I was giving you came out of demands. When there's a demand, then it keeps you thinking, what can we do to make it work? What solution can we bring? So sustainable solution that can help. And that's exactly what happens. For me, I believe that whatever we are doing here will be something that will change the face of aquaculture sector in the country. You know, because if you're able to get the right holding facilities, people will be able to do more and then be able to supplement whatever fish needs that we have in the country. And let me just add this, that you see now with the issue of the Galamsey, destroying most of our water bodies, now go to the River Pra, you cry. It means that sooner than later, we will have shortage of fish. You know, because you can't catch fish from those rivers any longer. Yeah. Most of these rivers where we do the Galamsey and all. And that is where these technologies come into play. So we need a system that will be sustainable and easy to use. You know, so in your backyard, you can have about 1,000 pieces of catfish. How much can you enjoy? How much can you consume? You know, so you realize that it's still the best way we can, you know, use to, I would say, mitigate against the effect of some of the Galamsey.
So the water bodies are being destroyed.
Exactly. So that is where, for me, I see this going places as far as aquaculture space is concerned in the country. Yes.
What should the state institutions or what should the government do in this state to help address the situation or help with kind of ideas you put out there to address this particular water and fish stocks problem?
Right. I think that there's I know that we have the Fisheries Commission, you know, the Ministry of Fisheries and Aquaculture Development, you know. They are doing their best. But I think in issues like this, where we have private sector, you know, driving, you know, and moving this whole thing, they should really have the right collaboration with the private sector. For me, if we decide to say that, okay, one district, one factory, let me not go there, it might not come into play as soon as we would want it. But imagine that for all the number of youth who are employed in our communities, every district decides that, okay, we want to set up a village we call the fish village, where we will have the ponds, we will have the processing facility, we will have a recreational facility where people can come and actually sit and enjoy the fish or come and buy fish. In every district in the country, let the government give us a enabling environment that, okay, we want every district or municipal executive to now take these things up and help their district. So we call the fish village. Look at the employment it's going to create for the youth. That's where the private-public partnership comes into play, the PPPs. And for me, that is all we want. It shouldn't come at any big cost. We can just, like I said, once you subscribe to a package like this, the training is even free. Technical support is even free. So that tells you that we are already, you know, poised to help the government to push this agenda. Imagine every district has this fish village I'm talking about, like the cottage, you know, and then it's pushing and then bringing employment, you know, young guys. And the people who work here are all young graduates who are finished and they are, you know, not doing anything and all. So for me, that the idea that the youth can lead this, you know, is where the government should come in and then push out. With a little push, we'll be able to make a big impact. We shouldn't politicize this at all. It should get to that point where we are serious about it, we know what we are doing, and then we'll take it up. And I believe that the impact will be massive. So the economics of going into catfish production with our system, it'll blow your mind.
Imagine you put in 14,000 cedis. You expect that in 6 months maximum, don't be surprised if I tell you can get back 9,000 cedis in 6 months.
That is with how much investment?
14,000 currently.
With how many fish stock?
So this is how it works. 1,000 pieces of catfish. You can get, worst case scenario, 60% as success. Okay. So it means that if in 6 months you end up getting, on the average, 1 kilogram of fish, that means you have 6,000 kilograms of fish to sell. Mm. Worst case scenario, you sell 1 kilo for 15 cedis. That is 9,000. So I'm still giving you worst case scenario. Trust me, you can have a success rate of 90% and above. So that enhances your rate of return, economics. So this is all I want to say, that as far as I am concerned, from my experience and from the experience of other clients that I've worked with, you can get a worst case scenario of 9,000 cedis back in 6 months. So it means that in a year, you can break even. Subsequently, once I put in 5,000 thereabout, I can get worst case scenario 9,000 cedis back. That is almost 100%
profit.
And it's crazy. Yes. All we want to do now is to be able to push this whole agenda of the catfish like it's been done in Nigeria in a special way where everyone is involved, you know. And I believe that once we are all creating the awareness in our own small area, wherever you find yourself, churches and, you know, our workplace and all that, we will be able to push this agenda to the, you know, its logical conclusion.
Is catfish production taking over the aquaculture space? Before, you know,
tilapia
was everywhere.
Right.
Has it changed? Or is it changing?
It's changing, yes. That's what I'll say. For me, tilapia is overrated. It is. Because everyone talks about tilapia, but the truth of the matter is that if you taste the cottage catfish grilled, trust me, you become a disciple of catfish. It's about value addition, trying to do things differently, trying to bring in variety. They grow faster and much bigger than catfish. Tilapia, sorry. So I don't see why we want to waste so much time on. I'm not saying tilapia is bad. I know there are conservatives who always want to go for tilapia. It's good. But the gray area is where the money is, trust me. If we taste catfish fillet, you know, and no one tells you it's catfish, you never know. You know, so there's a lot of potential. We can, you know, the plan is that we should be able to, like I said, even with the government intervention, we could even set up a factory, a processing factory for catfish. And even tilapia.
Yeah.
You know, if we are doing sardines, we are importing sardines into the country, we can do, you know, even much better product with catfish and tilapia in this country. If government should give us some support, you know, in the private sector, I believe that we can really make a headway. You know, for people to produce catfish, it shouldn't be a problem. Because once they know there's market like we are doing now, they will be
ready to go into it.
Yeah. You know, put in some money and then everyone will be happy along the value chain.
Yeah. Beautiful. So how many ponds do you have here and how many fish stocks are available now?
Currently, what we try to do is not to produce too much. The reason is that we have clients who are already producing, so we can buy from them and also give them that kind of incentive, you know, to continue to produce and expand their production for that matter. So here we have just about 6 tanks, and there was 6 tanks, about 2 of them are for taking stock from our clients, that the rest are under production and also for selling. So we sell some and then that kind of thing. So basically here we should have about 2,500 fishes here at the cottage.
So you have been speaking to engineer Dr. Shadrack Amponsa. From here we are going to the unit where the fish is grilled and prepared for the final consumption.
So right from feeding the fingerlings to getting it the required weight, it comes down to this point where the catfish or the tilapia is served for the customer to consume. My name is Prince Apia. Thank you for joining us on Food Chain today. For me, it is Banku and catfish.